If you're a medical doctor with a functional medicine practice, here are three things I'd like you to know about the legal landscape you are facing. First, understand that simply because you're doing functional medicine, you're not necessarily likely to have a higher malpractice risk and less likely than some years ago, but also know that strong outliers can and do stand out. Second, concierge medicine approach is not impossible, but it does pose legal challenges, and we help our clients through those. And third, the MSO model is potent in mitigating risks of corporate practice of medicine and fee-splitting violations, particularly in a multidisciplinary wellness center. We generally advise clients who decide to opt out of Medicare to inform patients regarding the physician's opt-out status in a form separate and apart from the private contract. You should provide this opt-out status information once you receive confirmation from the Medicare contractor. Here's an example of the sample language we suggested to one of our clients for this purpose. Physician has opted out of Medicare to provide services to Medicare patients under a private agreement. Medicare will not be billed for those services, and the patient is responsible for the entire fee charged by the physician. Physician fees are not subject to Medicare limits, and Medigap will not pay for those services. The patient has had opportunity to use another physician who is not opted out, but has freely chosen the physician. Here are some specific risk mitigation strategies we use for those who are not licensed as physicians or other healthcare practitioners. If you're a non-licensed individual who is professionally involved with the healthcare business, it's of vital importance to note that your role is clearly separated from any clinical, medical component of the business. You must be careful not to weigh in or participate in treatment of any of the patients. You may have unique experiences that provide valuable insights to the situation, but you must be careful to recognize the limitations of your role and take care to develop boundaries to ensure that you're not perceived as practicing medicine. The form we draft for our health coaching clients is modeled on the medical consent form, but if you're doing health coaching, you can't call it a medical consent. You got to call it something else. As well, some states have laws regulating non-licensed practitioners of the healing arts, such as in California. There's SB 577, codified as Business and Professions Code Section 2053.6. These so-called medical freedom statutes can have specific things they require to be in your consent disclosure. For example, under SB 577, your consent and disclosure must state the following: you, your name, is not a licensed physician or psychologist or provider of medical or psychological services. The services offered by you, provider, are alternative or complementary to healing arts services licensed by California. The services that provider offers are not licensed by California. Then you're required to describe the nature of the services you provide, the theory upon which they are based, and your education, training, and experience with those services. We were talking elsewhere about how it's good to find somebody who really understands the area and is a specialist. And Dan was telling some stories about legal encounters he's had, challenges he's had, how he went to somebody with the right knowledge, and how the efficiency of that specialist helped him power through in an efficient way so he could figure out what he needed to do. Just as his patients come to him because of his specialized in-depth expertise and years of experience. Before the lawsuit starts, there is this thing called a demand letter.
So I was breaking a rule from an agency that I had never heard of. And I got a demand letter, and it was scary. I was in violation of a regulation that I didn't even know existed. And in fact, the regulatory agency, I didn't even know existed. And in fact, when I asked a half a dozen doctor friends of mine, they didn't even know this regulatory agency existed either. You have to cease all business operations, you're in violation of this and this and that. And of course, I hit the total panic button. I saw literally my professional life flash in front of my eyes and ending gruesomely.
Every time an ad comes up on YouTube, notice what they claim about the product
and ask yourself, is this misleading in any way? You know, go onto the FTC website and look at how many companies have actually gotten in trouble for making false advertising about healthcare products. And under state law, also, this can affect your licensure because false advertising, it's grounds for discipline for professional misconduct. And look at some of the enforcement actions. And by the way, check out the penalties. They'll be staggering. They're in the millions. There's a lot to worry about, and people worry about the wrong thing. It takes a good issue spotter, a good differential diagnosis, a good audit of your practice to be able to spot these trouble areas. Don't paint a bullseye on your back. Understand the basics and get legal review and some legal education before the fact. You owe it to yourself, you owe it to your practice, you owe it to your noble profession to get the education and figure out where these lines are, because what is law but the drawing of lines?
California-specific question, does California allow for a percentage of revenue to be paid to the MSO? Yes, there is an allowance for that. It's in Business and Professions Code 650. It's a kind of a complex area of the law.
As with practicing medicine in general, in person, every state requires a particular provider to be licensed in that state. So if I want to move to New York and open up a medical practice, I have to be licensed in the state to do that. That's just cut and dry. That's no surprise to anyone.
I can't state more firmly and heartily how wonderful it was to find somebody who was actually an expert. It's worth every penny in your return of investment.
Good afternoon. My name is Manoj Reddy. I'm a radiation oncologist and integrative oncologist from Dallas, Texas, and the president of IOWG, the Integrative Oncology Working Group. Legal compliance with state and federal laws is a foundation for building a successful integrative medicine practice. I have found this area challenging, so I sought out the help of the Cohen Healthcare Law Group, an internationally recognized leader in healthcare and integrative medicine law, to help guide me as I start my integrative oncology practice. I'm grateful to the Cohen Healthcare Group for agreeing to provide this talk and hope this webinar is of value to you as it is to me.
Hello, my name is Michael H. Cohen, and I'm founding attorney of Cohen Healthcare Law Group. Our firm began in 1999 with the same motto that accompanies us today. We provide legal strategy and regulatory advice to businesses that accelerate health and wellness. In a few minutes, you'll learn more about the selected topic for today's webinar. Share time with our attorneys and get to see more about who's behind the scenes. We hope you enjoy our webinar. And we also look forward to seeing you back for upcoming webinars. By all means, reach out to our firm should you have any questions or comments. Again, it's such a pleasure to have you here. Welcome to our community. Visit our webpage if you have any other questions. And we look forward to beginning in just a few minutes. Enjoy.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another Cohen Healthcare Law Group webinar. My name is Dana, and I am the marketing director of Cohen Healthcare Law Group. With me is our tech guy, Oki, and our senior care team member, Christian. Today, we will talk about legal risks and risk mitigation for integrative medical practices. I know a lot of you have questions like, what documents do I need to be able to practice safely? Or am I allowed to practice in a certain state when I am licensed in another state? Well, today we will go over some of the common exposures involved and discuss key legal guidance in setting up and nurturing your integrative medical practice. I know most of you, if not all of you, are Integrative medical practitioners, but are there any non-Integrative practitioners in the room today? Nurses, entrepreneurs, I can see some that are not non-Integrative based on the clients list that we have. Well, I hope that this webinar will be able to give value to you and to your venture as well. Now, without further ado, let me introduce to you our keynote speakers for today, starting with our Senior Associate Attorney, Matthew Stocky. Matt, would you care to introduce yourself to the audience?
Thank you, Dana. Yes, hello, everyone. My name is Matt Stocky. I'm an attorney here at Cohen Healthcare Law Group and been here for a few years now and been practicing for almost 10 years and have focused on healthcare law specifically during my practice. I'm based in Orange County, California, if any of you are close by here. And I've been helping both healthcare providers, management companies, and health and wellness companies, mainly from the regulatory compliance standpoint, focusing on just that so far in my practice. And I look forward to helping you out today with this webinar.
Thank you. Joining Matthew today is our off-counsel attorney, Chris Esseltine. Chris?
Hi, thanks, Dana. My name is Chris Esseltine, and I am a healthcare and FDA attorney. I've worked for large law firms and large companies. I've represented Fortune 500 companies to small startups. If there's a company that has done something in the healthcare space, I've usually represented that kind of company, as well as many, many companies, food and beverage, pharmaceutical, medical device, certainly nutrition and supplement companies in the FDA space. So happy to be here with Cohen Healthcare Law Group, and also happy to be here today with you.
Thank you, Chris and Matt. We've asked the help of Integrative Oncology Working Group, or IOWG, to send us their best questions. And we have included their questions in the presentation for today. After this presentation, we will have a Q&A section where everybody's welcome to participate by using the Q&A icon that you'll find on your Zoom. So let's begin with our discussion. Our first question is, what are the common exposures involved that you have to watch out for when you're establishing and growing your Integrative medicine practice? Matt, would you like to answer this one?
Yes, thank you, Dana. I think this is a good question. Whether you are just starting up your practice or you've been at it for a few years now, maybe many years, it's always important to do that check-in and see if you are operating in a way that mitigates your risk as most as you can. I always like to start with integrative practice approach, as you all know, probably more so than I do, with your clinical knowledge. There are many approaches out there that are growing in popularity and have been legitimized in different scientific studies and research out there. I always say to clients when they come to me with their integrative practice, is the approach that you're using validated by a respectable minority of other physicians and clinicians in your community there? And or would it be? This is a question that often the medical boards have historically asked when there is some issue, some complaint that has been brought by a patient against the practice. If it's an approach that is not as widely used as the more conventional medical practices out there, they will oftentimes do some research into it whether it has been validated by scientific studies. You want, you know, scientifically sound studies that follow the standards of to arrive at such conclusions. That's always the substantive, is what kind of approach is the practice using, and would it be able to validate it as a safe approach for the patients? As that's, patient safety is always the number one concern of the boards out there. You know, another area where exposure is educating and informing your patients as to the particular approach. You know, there's some practices that obviously do it better than others, and we'll get into this later, but one obvious component of that is the written informed consent that your practice has with patients. Letting them know about the approach, the nature and the theory of your particular medical approach here. And not only just handing them a piece of paper, but having an ongoing discussion with the patients, answering their questions about the particular approach. Some other common areas I can just list off. Of course, having a good malpractice policy that addresses your specific approach here is recommended, highly recommended, making it clear that it's not necessarily a conventional approach to the practice of medicine is an important part of your discussion with a malpractice insurance agent. Sometimes there are specialty policies out there for functional medicine and other types of practices. Coordinating your care if your patient is seeing a more conventional medical practitioner, if they have a primary care provider, making sure that the care you're providing is not interfering in some way with the other doctor who is caring for the patient. Other quick ones, having a clear payment practices policy with your patients, letting them know that some of these services that are considered complementary alternative may not be covered by their insurance policy, whether that's PPO, HMO, or Medicare, letting them know. And for Medicare patients, there's specific forms you want to enter into if you believe your services won't be covered by their policy. So those are just some ones that I jotted down that I wanted to highlight. And Chris, you're welcome to jump in with anything that I missed.
Yeah, thanks, Matt. So you really have to be careful, just as Matt said, to make sure that the patient understands what he or she is getting into. There are people who don't really know, they don't understand the alternative or the functional medicine or the integrative part of what your practice is offering. And then there are people who understand it, but sadly they want to come back after the fact and complain and make a fuss. So you just always want to make sure that it's very clear what, not only what they're signing up for, the kind of treatment they'll be getting, but you want to make it clear that they know and acknowledge and can't come back after the fact and say that they didn't know. It's unfortunately just a fact of life in our world today, but especially in the healthcare field, that there are some people who want to cry foul after the fact, even if they did know what they were getting into. One of the other risks that I've seen in my practice is you have doctors who, or let's just say practitioners, who have a traditional medical component, and then they want to do other things like functional medicine or health coaching or that kind of thing. And in some cases, they want to say, well, all I'm doing for this patient is really what would be considered, say, health coaching. Sometimes it's telemedicine, and they're reaching out to patients in other states. The practitioners aren't necessarily licensed in those states, and yet they're seeing those patients in other states, which is a big no-no. So they've said, well, I'm just doing health coaching in those other states. Or to say, you know, even if it's a brick and mortar location and the patient comes in directly in person, and, you know, the practitioner wants to argue, well, I'm not really practicing medicine in this particular case because I'm doing health coaching. If you have a license, that's what the states will look at. If you are doing what would be considered health coaching and what someone could do, not needing a medical license, it really doesn't matter, because if you have that license, those patients are coming in under the auspices of that provider-patient relationship and under the auspices of that license. So be careful that you're not switching hats, right? Well, right now I'm wearing the health coaching hat. Now, if you're a doctor and you have a patient and you're doing health coaching, you're allowed to do that under your license as a doctor. The state, if anybody ever complained, if you ever got audited, the state would not consider that activity health coaching or this other, you know, sort of alternative thing, anything other than really the practice of medicine, because you're allowed to do those things under your license. So just be careful that you don't start to divide your practice up into different components. Realize it's all going to be, in almost every case, under your license and therefore considered your regular practice, the practice of medicine. So that's one thing to watch out for. Another thing is make sure that you're actually trained. I know it's a strange thing to say. Make sure you're actually trained in the alternative things or the complementary things that you're bringing to the table in your practice. There are a lot of practitioners, chiropractors, naturopaths, nurse practitioners, doctors, what have you, that want to make a little extra money doing something more, or they would like to get out of more of the traditional things into more of the holistic or functional medicine or alternative space. And they really aren't trained in those particular things. They don't have specialty. They don't have any kind of certification or training. So make sure that if you're going in a different direction or adding something complementary or integrative, that you actually have that training, because if there is any kind of harm, or even if a patient says, well, this didn't work, if they find out you don't have specific training in that, that can get you in trouble. And of course, just in general, you want to make sure you have training in things that you are giving your patients and treatments that you're offering. And especially if you're holding yourself out in any way, on your website, marketing, even speaking directly to a patient, if you're holding yourself out as a specialist in a certain area, make sure you actually have training in that specialty.
Okay, great. Thank you so much for your answers, Chris and Matt. And I'm sure there are a limited number of exposures involved, but what's important is you find a lawyer that suits your practice. Would you like to move on to the next question? Okay, so do you have to be licensed to offer telemedicine consultation or second opinions in the US or within state or outside the US? Are there states that allow you to provide second opinions or telehealth visits without the need for licensing? Chris?
Yeah, I'll take that. Thank you. So as I mentioned a little bit in the previous answer, if you are reaching out to a patient in another state, or if they reach out to you from another state, every single state in the union, with the exception of Florida to an extent, says that you have to be licensed in that state. So if it's a situation where the patient comes to you in your state, sees you in person, or even, I guess, by telemedicine is fine, and that person is visiting another state, or maybe it's an elderly person, a snowbird, and they're staying in Florida for 4 months. If their residence isn't in that other state, and it is in the state where you are, it's usually fine to do that. There are no specific laws in states saying, yes, it's fine to see a patient in our state, so long as that patient doesn't officially reside in the state. But that's generally the rule of thumb, and no one's gotten in trouble for reaching out to another state where that patient isn't really a resident of that state. But if the patient lives in that other state, resides in that other state, you do need to be licensed in that other state to practice telemedicine. Otherwise, the states would consider it practicing medicine in their state without a license. So be very careful of that. The great thing is, there have been measures taken by the various states to make it a lot easier for practitioners to get licensed in these other states. So that's a great thing. One of the few positive things that happened with COVID is those efforts were made, but you still have to make sure you're licensed to see residents of another state. Now, second opinions are a bit of a gray area simply because some people consider them the practice of medicine and some do not. So for example, if a patient reaches out to a physician directly for a second opinion, that physician now becomes that patient's provider and medical advice is being given directly to the patient. If the patient's physician, whether it's primary care physician or a specialist, reaches out to a physician of another state, and it's just a consultation between those two physicians, that generally isn't considered the practice of medicine, and therefore you don't have to be licensed in that other state. It's a bit of a gray area. The states really haven't codified this whole situation, but you just always want to be careful doing something directly with the patient via telemedicine or otherwise in a state where you're not licensed.
Thank you so much, Chris. Our third question is it possible to create a separate integrative medicine practice with an insurance-based practice? If so, how? Matthew?
Thank you, Dana. And I just wanted to add one other thing to what Chris was saying. I've been getting a lot of clients asking about the different, basically, as Chris referenced, during COVID, there was a relaxation and in some cases exceptions made in different states allowing out-of-state practitioners to practice there. And there's a lot of rumors about that and whether they still apply. A lot of them have closed that down. You know, it's really a state-by-state question. Some of these laws have very specific situations that are defined in their laws, defining when and, you know, for how long a practitioner can provide services to a patient residing in another state. So keep that in mind. It's really a moving target depending on the state. And Chris also did mention some states offer a fast track to get licensed. You know, if you have a lot of patients that are going to be in a certain area now, the Interstate Medical Licensure Compact offers a fast track. Certain states are part of that. You know, if it was worth it for you to get licensed in another state, that's definitely something to look into there. And with regard to the next question, yes, this is a very interesting question, and we get it a lot. Is it possible to create a separate integrative medicine practice with an insurance-based practice? Again, it's one of those questions that will change depending on what kind of insurance companies you're credentialed with. For the most part, and this is a very general statement for today's discussion, integrative practice services, functional medicine, holistic care is generally not covered by insurance. Of course, that's going to depend on the specific billing manual of the insurance company, which are updated from time to time. And a lot of those insurance companies are now recognizing these integrated practice services as covered in certain cases. So can you start a separate cash practice when you are credentialed with insurance, Medicare? With Medicare, what I've found is that your NPI, your name with Medicare will follow you around even to other practices that where you practice. And there's going to be some level of risk offering those services in a cash context when you are opted in to Medicare. Same kind of idea goes with the private insurance context. Some of those provider agreements with the insurance companies will even specifically prevent you from doing this. And having represented some practices before undergoing audits, I've even seen the insurance companies point to those other practices as some type of foul play in their eyes. You know, it does come down to whether the services you're offering in your cash practices are even covered. If they are covered services and you're charging a cash rate, that's when the risk is very high that you may be violating a provider agreement with your insurance company or with Medicare. If they're non-covered services, the risk may be lower because they wouldn't have even been covered in your insurance practice. But still, there are those sections to look out for in your provider agreements. If they try to prevent you from doing that, they could say that you're in breach of contract of the provider agreement and theoretically make an issue out of it. So, Chris, you have anything to add to that you've seen?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I've had clients come to me and say, well, I'm working at a hospital, so I'm credentialed with Medicare, but I want to start this separate cash-based practice. And can I do that? And unfortunately, you're right that there's a rule that's buried in a bunch of rules. It's really hard to find, but nevertheless, it's there and Medicare will hold you to it, which is that Medicare follows the provider. So you can't just open a separate practice and say, okay, this is cash pay because I opt out of Medicare. It's all or nothing. So if you opt out of Medicare, realize you can't be credentialed with Medicare in any other job, any other practice. And it's true, there are some insurance providers, some of the commercial payers, for example, that are fine with you charging, say, a membership fee or a concierge fee, something like that, or maybe charging a little extra money for longer patient visits, things like that. And then there are commercial payers who say that's absolutely a violation of your contract with us. Medicare will absolutely find that to be a violation. So the rule of thumb is if it's something that the payer, whether it's Medicare or someone else, pays for already, you can't charge a fee for that to the patient. Medicare is very, very strict about that. And so some people will say, well, I'm giving my patients 24-hour access on my cell phone. And Medicare says that's something that technically is covered by Medicare. If you want to give someone that much access, that's fine. We pay for access to the provider, so you can't charge extra for that. Or some providers say, well, I want to give these people an hour. I mean, I do functional medicine, so they need at least an hour visit so I can go over everything. On the initial visit, it's 3 hours that I need. And Medicare says, we pay for the visit. Now, they pay for maybe a 15-minute visit, but Medicare says, we pay for the visit. Therefore, if you want to take 3 hours, that's your business. You're free to, but you can only get reimbursed for those 15 minutes, and you can't charge the patient extra money for a longer visit. So the key to it is finding those services that absolutely are not covered by Medicare. And it's hard to figure that out. There's a bit of a gray area there sometimes. We do have the expertise to help you through that whole process and figure out what technically, under the definition of Medicare or the commercial payers, is a covered service, what is not. And we can help suggest some things that would you could integrate into your practice, but you've got to be very careful, especially with Medicare, about charging money for things that these payers consider that they already cover.
Okay, thank you, Chris and Matthew. Let's move on to the fourth question. Are there options to be able to see Medicare patients in a direct pay model without opting out of Medicare? Would you like to answer?
I'll take that one, but I will give credit to my colleague, Matt, because he came up with this great idea. So Medicare only applies, obviously, to people who qualify for Medicare. So of a certain age, And there are some other things. For example, if you're in renal failure, Medicare will cover you. So you can do a cash pay model and not opt out of Medicare. You're just not allowed to see the Medicare patients. Or if you do, let them let Medicare pay for those services. But those who don't qualify for Medicare don't fall under that Medicare rule, obviously. And so you're not bound by it. So you can do the cash pay model, but always make sure that if there's any kind of commercial payer contract that you're bound to, that you're allowed to do what you want to do within that contract as well.
Just thinking out loud here, Chris, you know, if a practice decides to see people who are not Medicare eligible and charging those cash rates, it's going to be important to for your practice to really monitor your patients, especially those that are on the cusp of becoming Medicare eligible. The minute they turn 65, whatever the age is now, that they are then treated differently and those cash rates are no longer being charged.
So the fifth question that we do have, we've broken down into three. The first bullet that we have is, what kind of a risk waiver should you ask patients to sign to offer them integrative advice or treatment? Would you like to answer this, Matt?
Sure. Thanks, Dana. This is a good question. And I always say to even conventional practitioners, the informed consent is going to be one of your best allies in the event that there is a patient that makes a complaint to a medical board, initiates a malpractice action, whatever it might be, whether it's frivolous or not. The first things that at least the board always asks for is the records from the day of the treatment, and maybe records over a period of time, the episode of treatment. They would ask for those records as well as the informed consent that you had the patient sign. Again, there's state laws will vary in terms of what those informed consents need to contain, the different elements. But the general elements that are required, as you know already, are the risks involved with the service, the benefits, the alternatives, and of course, information about the service, the nature and the purpose of that service. And in most cases, even the risk level of the alternatives as well, so they can make an informed, balanced judgment as to whether to proceed with these services. And I'm bringing up an example here of a state. Texas is a state that has very comprehensive rules that apply to integrative practitioners. And Texas law says that whenever complementary alternative licensed services are provided, they list out very specific elements that need to be in that informed consent. And I'll just name a few of those right now. The objectives, the expected outcomes, or the goals of the proposed treatment, the risks and benefits, as I said, the extent the proposed treatment could interfere with any ongoing or recommended medical care. And one that I thought was notable was you should have, as the practitioner, you should have evidence or file with studies indicating that the treatment offered would have a favorable risk-benefit ratio compared to other treatments for the same condition. You know, I would even carry, even though this is just limited to Texas, these very specific elements, and there's a few others I didn't mention, I think it's a good principle to use in other states as well. I don't think there's anything wrong with a practitioner over-explaining the risks and the different information about the services you'll provide. End of the day, if the board saw that, that would most likely be in your favor, that you have informed them appropriately. Those are some major elements that I always recommend, no matter whether a client is from Texas or another state. Of course, if you are providing health coaching services, non-licensed services, some states have safe harbor laws for these non-licensed complementary and alternative services that also require specific elements to be in those informed consents. They're also called informed consents, even though it's not licensed services. But again, you can carry these same principles, whether or not your state has a safe harbor, to other states. It's going to be a state-by-state analysis for the most part here. Some states are a little less open to the idea of complementary alternative integrative practice than others. But you know, if you're moving forward, these are the principles that you can use and implement in your practice.
So I'll take the next two. What kind of language can you use for your consent forms? Clear. the biggest word, the most important word I can use here is clear. Again, it's all about making sure that the patient understands what he or she is getting into, what's going to happen. Then there are no surprises. Then they can't come back and claim this or that or complain. But in terms of specific language, it really depends. Again, as Matt said, on your state, it depends on exactly what the particular treatment is or what you as a practitioner will be doing. So it's going to be a situational analysis, but again, we can help you in whatever your situation is with whatever the language needs to be. And are there situations where consent might not be necessary? We're lawyers. We would never say, oh yeah, absolutely. Now, in a general sense, are there situations where you don't need consent? Well, sure. They've been informed already. They've signed consent forms. They've signed your waiver forms or your terms and conditions. You don't need to get consent every single time you see a patient or every single time you perform a particular procedure. If it's something new and something they don't know about, especially if it's a little riskier or a little scarier for the patient or what have you, then sure, it's always a good idea to get another consent just in case for that brand new procedure that they haven't been exposed to, that they haven't formally consented to. But generally, no, you don't need redundant consents.
I already see a lot of questions on our Q&A, but we would just like to introduce to you our newest brand, MSO attorneys. And for those of you who have MSO-related concerns or managed services organization, you may visit our website, www.mso-attorney.com. And yes, I think Christian has sent the link to the chat. Okay, so Matt and Chris, would you like to start having the Q&A section? You can pick the questions yourselves.
Sure. Just look through these questions here. Looks like we got a few of them. I see a lot of questions about what is adequate training. And it's a good question, a fair question. I don't have a specific answer for you today, but what I can say is that in general, if you're going to be certified as a specific type of practitioner, you want to check out the organization that is doing the certification, number one. And there are some states, some medical regulations in certain states that recognize in their regulations certain organizations for credentialing and for certifications. So that's one place to start by looking at the state regulations there. And there may be some information about that directly on the medical board of your state. A lot of times those FAQs, the little drop-down tab about laws and regulations are very helpful, and they provide links to different publications about certifying organizations like that. So I think it does have to do with the quality of the organization. And each organization is going to develop its own standards for demonstrating competency in a certain approach. And so, you know, with regard to how long do you how many training classes or programs do you need to take? You know, that's most likely going to have to do with the kind of approach, the kind of services, and the standards of that organization, and potentially any state regulations if that state has comprehensive regulations like that.
Chris?
I see, there are two here I wanted to address. One asked about the specific telemedicine law in terms of licensing in Florida, how it's a little different than the other 49 states. Florida says you don't have to be licensed to practice law to do telemedicine, but you do have to be registered. So there's a specific link you go on and register and say, I'm a physician, I am practicing medicine and licensed in such and such a state, and I'm registering to see patients in Florida via telemedicine only. So it allows you to do that. Otherwise, the other 49 states say you actually have to be licensed. There is another question. Yeah, patients flying in to see a particular practitioner in a given state. They're from another state. They fly in to see that practitioner. They fly back to their home state. Can the practitioner follow up via telemedicine in that other state? And the answer is it's not clear. There's no statutory authority to do that, except to say there is a responsibility when you have a provider-patient relationship to follow up, to make sure that the person's taken care of, to say, oh, well, they've gone back to the other state, I can't talk to them, would be irresponsible. So because that provider-patient relationship is already established, especially where the patient came into that provider's state, even though there's no absolute statute saying, yes, this is fine, nobody's gotten in trouble for doing that, and it certainly would be appropriate to do that. How long that could go on? Would it be an ongoing thing where now you're only doing telemedicine, reaching out to that state where you're not licensed? Again, there's no bright line rule, but you don't want to abuse the privilege of being able to follow up after an in-person visit.
I see one question. Yeah, I see one question here about if you have a cash practice, a cash integrative medicine practice. I think the question is how to make sure that you don't have to do primary care as the practitioner. That has to do with informing your patients in your informed consent that, you know, you are a specialty integrative practice and only providing those services. Sometimes in these informed consents, when I prepare those, I will put a specific check the box or initial here as the patient that you have a PCP, a primary care provider, that you will continue to see. And even sometimes, you know, and I acknowledge that I must undergo a physical exam every year with my primary care provider. There's certain protections you can add to those documents if you wanted to be overly careful there. But, you know, the primary idea is just letting them know clearly, maybe even putting it on page one, that you only provide these services at the practice. You're not responsible for the primary care that services that are provided at the other practice. Again, there's going to be some states that have some regulations about that and maybe specific notices that need to be in the informed consent. That'll be just a state-by-state analysis there.
I see a question here. What if you have Medicaid patients? So Medicaid will pretty much follow the Medicare rules, and it's CMS, right? It's the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services. So if you have opted into Medicaid, generally you can't charge money for services that are provided by Medicaid. But more importantly, if a patient is on Medicaid, there isn't a big chance they're going to be able to afford your cash pay services anyway. So that should just inform you on a practical level. Let's see, and there was another question here are things, if you're a physician, for example, and you're doing things like nutritional counseling and health coaching and that kind of thing, is that covered under your malpractice insurance? And we really didn't talk about malpractice too much, but generally, if something's covered under your license, if you're allowed to do something under your license. An MD can't adjust the spine, for example, like a chiropractor can, but an MD certainly can give all kinds of nutrition counseling and things like that, things that, say, a health coach could do, an MD is entitled to do, and so therefore it's under the auspices of the license and therefore under that medical malpractice insurance.
I'm seeing a few questions here about how often, or A, do you need patients to sign the informed consent? Yes, they should be signed. They must be signed by the patients. And then B, how often should you have them sign that informed consent? And it's a good question. And you know, most of the laws out there don't have a clear answer for that. I recently looked into it, and what I can say is that the general recommendation there is to get your patients to re-sign those informed consents every year. If you are, you know, there's exceptions to that. If your practice mid-year decides to offer integrative services, integrative medicine services, and you were a conventional practice before that, that would be a good time to send them an updated informed consent, describing the nature and the theory of those integrative medicine services. As your practice evolves and adds new services, you know, we recommend getting a new informed consent signed, talking about those new services.
There's a question here from someone. They wanted a little clarification on what was talked about earlier about telemedicine. Yes, the law is you need to be licensed wherever the patient is physically present during the telemedicine visit. So when I said reside, I mean, you know, not necessarily their place of residence per se, but wherever they are at the time of the visit. However, the states are, I mean, there's some gray area there as well, because again, if someone is a resident of Florida and they're visiting their mother in Washington state for 2 days, is that really a violation? Are you practicing medicine in the state of Washington if it's just telemedicine and the person happens to be there? It isn't black and white, but again, no one has gotten in trouble for doing something like that because there is that patient-provider relationship that's established. There is a need to be seen, and the fact that you're just traveling or something, the states don't care about that. What they care about is the actual invasion of their state by someone who isn't licensed in their state. So if you have a resident of Florida and they happen to be in Washington state, it's really still the state of Florida that governs the licensing and that interaction between the provider and patient. So is it 100% black and white? Oh, it's okay to do that. No, but at the same time, nobody's gotten in trouble for it for a reason, and that's because the states care about taking care of their residents, looking out for their residents, and not so much where someone's traveling for a few days.
Okay, Matthew, would you like to answer one last question?
Yeah, I see one about if you are a licensed healthcare provider in one state, but want to offer nutrition and health coaching via telehealth in other states where you're not licensed, what would you need to set up a separate business entity for the health coaching to differentiate, or would you need to set up a separate business entity for the health coaching to differentiate it from the medical practice? Yeah, I've had a number of clients come to me with that same question. And, you know, if you're licensed, for example, in California, and you want to start offering in only California, and you want to start offering health coaching services, nutrition services to clients across the country. Yes, in that case, and you know, it's going to be a case by case depending on your situation, but I would recommend setting up a different company, non-professional company, when providing those health coaching services in other states. It helps differentiate you as your medical cap from your non-licensed services cap. One heads up about providing health coaching services and nutrition services in other states in a non-licensed capacity is that Some states do have licensed nutritionist boards, and they require you, and they only allow licensed nutritionists in that state to provide those nutrition services. The definition of what is nutrition services varies on the state. And so you want to always try to distinguish your services, if you're not licensed there, of course, from the state law. But yes, that is theoretically possible. Other states just don't have licensed nutritionist boards at all, California being one of them. So there's a little more leeway in certain states, but it's a moving target based on the state at the end of the day.
Thank you so much. Let me just jump in there.
Matt's exactly right. There are some states that require you be licensed as a dietitian or nutritionist. If you're doing anything specific, I mean, if you're giving a person an individualized eating plan, that would be required. That would be considered, you know, being a nutritionist or dietitian. So make sure that you're licensed if you have to be. But also, the one thing you want to make sure you do, if you are a doctor, a chiropractor, whatever it is, and you just want to do these nutrition consulting services, make sure in all of your consent forms and all of your marketing materials that you say, while I'm a doctor, this is not under my license. This does not create a doctor-patient relationship, et cetera, et cetera. Make sure that's always very clear to not only your clients, because they're no longer patients, but also in all your marketing materials, so you can't get accused of practicing medicine out of state without a license.
Okay, thank you so much, Chris and Matthew. And thank you so much for sending in all your questions, for those questions that we were able to answer. And for those who have further questions, you are always welcome to reach out to us. You may call us at 310-844-3173. I think Christian has sent the link for our contact form. And I guess that wraps up for today's webinar. For those familiar names that we have joining us today, thank you so much for watching out for our webinars and for always giving us your time. And for those fresh names that we have here in the room, thank you so much for joining us. And we hope to see you again on the next webinar. And thank you. Goodbye for now.